Hello everyone out there, I'm sitting here with Joa.
That's it.
I'm sitting here with Joa from Holland, and we have been communicating a little on Facebook, and you've been really strong in the word, and we had some good talks, and it had been really, really good talking with him. And then he came here to the Jesus Center in Denmark with his wife and a friend to meet us, and we've been sitting talking about salvation. That there is so much misunderstanding out there when it comes to salvation. Yeah. When it comes to understanding that salvation is not actually that fixed point, that second you get saved, but salvation is more that road. Like Jesus, he was the road. He was the truth, but he was the road that lead to something. And the Bible is talking about a narrow road and a broad road. It's talking about the road of sin and the road of the spirit, and talking about we need to walk that road. Yeah. And we did a talk yesterday, I think it was, about it. And I was like, this is good. This is like, this is good. And I want people to hear this. So therefore, we have decided to do a video here where we will take you through some of the things the Bible is saying about salvation as a road. We are going to look also about where baptism fit in, because as you know, there is still many, many people who have problem with baptism, because if they only study baptism and they see that baptism is a salvation thing, but they don't understand that faith is also a salvation thing, and that repentance is also a salvation thing, and the one who keep on to the end is also a salvation thing. Yeah. So we'll try to make this clear, hopefully, in this video. First, we want to start with testimony.
Yeah.
Because for me, when I heard his testimony, it was a little like what I experienced. I would say today it took me 6 years. I got saved, but it took me 6 years to really be born again. I remember that day I was sitting in my office, I was studying the word, I was studying Romans 6, and suddenly something exploded and it became a new beginning for me. And I heard that your story is also somehow similar.
It is similar, yes.
So let's start with your testimony.
Well, actually it took me 19 years, so okay. It took a little longer. I repented at a young age. I was a young guy, and I turned to the Lord, and I knew he was real. And I got spirit-filled when I was 11, only 11. But then I kept on living my life, really wanting to serve the Lord with everything I had. I mean, I gave it my all. People that know me, I did church, everything I could. I tried to work at my salvation as much as I could, but I never found the real freedom. Mm. The freedom of sin, and the freedom to live for Jesus with everything I had. And I got spirit-filled when I was 11, but only when I was 30, about 3 years ago, I understood the full picture of salvation. That is not only just repenting and then that's it, we go from there. No, but that there's a salvation, a whole picture, a road to walk in. And when I understood that, I was really free. Mm. And a freedom I could have never imagined, a freedom that I even thought wasn't even real anymore. That I thought, well, this is just our struggle, you know, as Christians you have to struggle against sin and try to overcome it, you know, this is a life struggle. And I didn't believe that the gospel was the way of true salvation. That the gospel, only the gospel, is the way to set us free from sin. Not through own works, not through me trying all these years, for 19 years, from 11 till 30, I couldn't do it. Mm. I gave it everything I got, but I couldn't do it. It's all through grace. And only when I understood the big picture is when it came alive to me, and I was set free from that moment. I remember you saying at the Pioneer School, I think, that when you believed what the baptism was all about, mm. that there was a salvation, that like a freedom moment within mm. you. And I experienced the same thing. It's not fake, it's real. Mm. Mm. It wasn't like a rainbow appeared or something. But the boss, I knew, yes, I am free. Finally, I am free.
For me, I think your story is the same. If we look at the Bible, we have Romans, the book of Romans, that is an amazing book. And we are going to actually go through Romans out from the Old Testament somehow, yeah, to put it together with the Israelites. But if you look at Romans, Romans 6, where it's talking about the baptism, the freedom from sin, we read words like, you're not slave to sin, you are free from sin. You're not bound to sin. Yeah. Sin have no dominion over you because you're not under the law anymore. You're under grace.
Yeah.
That freedom is something many people read about, but it's something that needs to be experienced.
Yeah.
Then people misunderstand Romans because they read from one line to another and don't know that in the Roman Greek way of writing it, it sometimes go in circles like this, like Hebrew way, where he take Romans 6, the new life, Romans 7, he just go and talk about the old life and then the new life again, and then the old life again and the new life in Romans 8.
Yeah.
So in Romans 7, there is some verses where he said that he's slave bound to be under sin. And it don't fit up match with Romans 6, where he say we are not bound, we are not slaves.
Exactly, because I believe that Paul says, hey, I do the things that I do not want to do, and the things that I do not want to do, those are the things that I do. And I thought, well, that's my struggle. I identify with that. This must be the Christian life.
And it was what I thought. It was like, okay, this is my experience.
Yeah.
But is it not your experience now?
No, because when I understood that that's exactly what he has been set free from, then I was free as well, because salvation and freedom is not through works, it's not through something you do, it's through faith. And when your works come together with your faith, then it's power. I was baptized when I was 15, but I did not have the right faith. I was baptized in the sense of, well, now I really go for Christ, you know, this is my real choice, you know, that was my baptism. But I did not understand that there was freedom from my sin in baptism. That I was dead to sin and alive to Christ. Dead to the law and alive to Christ. Only when my faith came together with my works 15 years ago, it was power.
I would say some of you know that we have re-baptized many people because there was many people who got baptized in the name of religion who later heard the full gospel and got baptized again. And there they experience their freedom. Me, myself, like Joanne, have never been rebaptized because we already had repented before, but we did not have the faith. There you don't need to get rebaptized, you just need to understand it and live in it.
Yeah.
And I know it's difficult for some people to understand, but for me, when I came to church first time and repented and repented, the Holy Spirit came, I was told, congratulations, you are born again. But I wasn't born out of water and spirit at that time. 6 years later, everything came together. When the repentance, the baptism, the Holy Spirit, the faith, all came together.
Yeah.
And for me, it was also like I've been walking Romans 7. The good things I want to do, I do not do. And the bad things I do not want to do, I do. It's not me, but sin who dwells in me and my miserable person who can save me for this wretched person I am. And, and it was like a fight, like, I cannot experience freedom.
Yeah.
But if we look at salvation, you can then go to the Old Testament. But if you look at salvation, we need to ask ourselves, what are we saved from? Because many people say, hey, we are saved from hell.
Yeah.
We are saved from the wrath of God, the Bible says.
Yeah.
But it's not the wrath is not without a reason, no. And it's not because we are saved from hell. No, we are saved from our sins.
Yes.
Our sins that do that we are under the wrath of God. Our sins that are doing that the righteousness of God is going to judge us to hell. Jesus is the Lamb of God who was going to take away our sins. He got the name Jesus so he should save us from our sins.
Yes.
To be saved from sins is much more than to be forgiven and continue in sin the rest of your life.
Yes. Yeah.
To be saved from sin is to get a new heart, get rid of the old body, get a new spirit and walk a new life.
Yes.
So salvation is more than just that moment and now you go to heaven. Salvation is to becoming a new creation. There's so much more in it. And can you start with the Old Testament? I want to say again, what he's going to explain now meets up with the New Testament. Remember the early apostles, they preached without the New Testament. The New Testament was not there at that time.
Yeah.
So when they were standing up preaching, they were not quoting Romans like we are, Corinthians 10, like I'm going to quote later. Because Romans, Corinthians, the whole New Testament was not yet written. They were writing it at that moment.
Yeah.
So their Bible, when they always quote scriptures, scriptures was Old Testament.
Yeah.
And there is some very, very clear picture in Old Testament about the salvation we are walking in. Pictures that the New Testament authors are using again and again and again to explain the gospel.
Yeah.
So can you start? Where do we start?
Yeah, sure. Because God showed me this picture, and it's very easy, actually. The apostles, I think they preach the same message because they use the same terminology. The people of Israel, just tell the story real short, you know, for the people that don't know. The people of Israel were captured into Egypt, and they were taken slaves to Egypt. Then they cried out to God, God, we are slaves here in Egypt. Please come and save us. And God, the Father, responded, and he sent Moses, and he sent the plagues, and, you know, the blood on the door, and they had the feast of the unleavened bread, you know, and with that, they went out of Egypt. Taken out of Egypt, Pharaoh wanted to come back with all his horses and all his army and take the people of Israel back into captivity. This is important. But God had another plan. He wasn't done yet. So he took the people of Israel, took them through the Red Sea. He divided the sea. They all went through. And when Pharaoh and his army came after them, the Red Sea closed and they were drowned. But then they were saved, you would think. But they continued in the desert. But what happened? They all died. The whole generation died in the desert. And even a few and the next generation only made it to the promised land. And the promised land, Jude says in Jude 4 and 6, that the promised land is a picture of our salvation. Mm. Not just what we receive here on earth, but our eternal salvation. Mm. Heaven or not, to put it real simply. So God started with this picture. So Israel was taken as slaves in Egypt. Mm. And the Bible says that Egypt is a picture of the world. And everybody that commits sin, says Jesus, is a slave of sin. Yeah. A real slave of sin. Mm. So you are bound to sin because everybody has committed sin. This is what Romans 1 and 2 says, that the Gentiles committed sin by living through the flesh. And we all know the flesh, you know, sexual sin, drinking, all the things. And the Jews were breaking the law. Mm. So they were both condemned to sin. Mm. They both committed sin, the Gentiles by lawlessness and the Jews by breaking the law they had from God.
And this is the first chapters in the Roman where they end up there. There is no righteous, nobody seeking God. No. Everyone is lost, everyone is under sin.
Yeah.
Because it's not the one who have the law, it's the one who keep the law. And we have the conscience, but still we don't live it. And they have the law and they do not live it. Yeah. So people under sin, they're in slave.
They are slaves, both the Jews and the Gentiles, both slaves of sin. Mm. So, but God had a plan, and the plan was to take them out of Egypt. And how did they do that? By the sprinkling of blood on the doors, which is the picture of Jesus. He died. Mm. Through his blood, we have salvation. His blood is the forgiveness of sin. His blood paid the price.
And this is the firstborn where the judgment was that the firstborn in every family should die.
Yes.
And Pharaoh also, of course, lost his son there. But those who had the blood from the goat and sheep did not lose. The death walked past and did not lose the firstborn. It's so beautiful, all the pictures, like Abraham before there was going to offer his son at Golgotha,
actually,
the same
mountain,
and offer his son, and God have a sacrifice instead of his son. And Jesus was now the firstborn. God loved the world, so he gave his only begotten son to die for all. So there's so many clear pictures.
Yeah, and it was only through the blood that Pharaoh, because they had the 10 plagues, but only when the blood came that Pharaoh said, now leave us, go out of my country, I don't want you anymore. And they were set free. But God says you cannot go with the leaven. Mm. And the Bible speaks that the leaven is sin. You know, the leaven of the Pharisees, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. Mm. It's sin. So the people of Israel were set free through the blood, but they had to leave the leaven behind. They had to leave sin behind. Mm. So through the blood of Jesus and through repentance, they were taken out of Egypt.
Mm. Well, let's say through the blood of Jesus, through repentance, they were saved.
They were saved out of Egypt.
Yeah. Like through the blood of Jesus, through repentance, we are saved.
Yeah.
Out of this world.
Yeah.
Out of sin.
Exactly. Yeah. That's Romans 3-5, to say it simply. Yeah. Justification. Yeah. And when we repent, when we change our attitude towards God, God changes attitude towards us. But the problem was, if Israel would have stayed there, out of Egypt, what would have happened? Pharaoh would have come back and taken them back into captivity, into the bondage of sin. And that is where I lived all my life in that circle. I was forgiven, oh yes, I am forgiven. But that's where it ended. And I was taken back to sin, back to a selfish life, back to living for myself instead of living for God. And I wanted it, but I could not. And I was in that circle. I did the things that I did not want to do. And the things that I did want to do, I did not do.
So let's say like this. Let's say this is Egypt. This is this world. The Israelite was captured in this world by the blood of Jesus, by the repentance and faith. They were saved out of Egypt.
Yep.
Now they walked out here, they left, and there was a... They were rejoicing.
Yeah,
they were having million people.
They were shouting, we are saved, we are saved.
And I would say for me, but then what happened? That shout, that joy, short time later became sorrow because suddenly, oh no, we are dying, we are dying, we are dying. And as you said, this is not only theology, this is what many people experience, what
this
I experienced.
Because real practical
life. Remember when I got saved through faith and repentance out of this world, I came up here. The first month, I was just happy. I was just rejoicing, and it was just Jesus. Everything was so good. Yeah. But then I started to fight more and more and more, and I felt like the old life just came like. It was like I was walking and falling and walking and falling and walking and falling. Like something was drawing me back. Something was fighting me.
And that was because we were still slaves, in fact. Even though we were taken out of Egypt, we were not free yet. Why? Because Pharaoh is still coming to take us back. So there has to happen something to make us free. Even though we were taken out of Egypt, I was not yet free. And the problem is that Jesus says, a slave does not abide in the house forever.
The son.
But the son abides in the house forever.
And it's just there where Jesus said, when the son set you free, you are free indeed.
Yeah, free from what? From committing sin. Yeah. From doing sin, not just the penalty of sin. No, you shall be free from committing sin.
Yeah. So you said, this is salvation out of this world, salvation out of Egypt, but you are still a slave because you are still here and the old life is not dealt with. It's still there and it's trying to take you back. So now you need to be saved one more time. You need to be saved from Egypt. You need to be saved from the old life. And Romans is talking about that as...
Romans 6, about being saved from your flesh that was keeping you as a slave to sin. Yeah. So through the baptism, let's make this the Red Sea.
This is the Red Sea.
So they were rejoicing right here, but Pharaoh was coming, bringing them back to sin, that circle. But now they went through the Red Sea. So they were baptized, says the Bible, into Moses, which is a picture of Jesus. So at first they repented to the Father, and now they were baptized into Jesus. And only after they came out of the baptism, out of the Red Sea, they could truly say, I am now free. Hallelujah. And they were rejoicing, they made a song, you know, and they were dancing together. So what happened? The sea closed, and Pharaoh was drowned. Many people mistake this for demons and all that stuff. No, we're talking about sin. Sin is drowned in the Red Sea. The slavery to sin is drowned in the Red Sea. So effectively, what does the baptism do for us? It gives us a choice. Whereas before I was a slave and I just did the things I did not want to do, now I have a true, genuine choice to either obey something else, yeah, or to go back to the flesh.
So we talk about the Bible and talk about baptism. Baptism is a barrier. You bury the old life. That body that is dead under sin, that body that is bound to sin, we need to get rid of.
Get rid of it.
We need to bury it.
Yeah.
Because now it's like a new life has started. This is another picture. The heart, new heart, the law is written on our heart. We now have the knowledge, like the will to do what is right, but we cannot because the body is slave to sin.
Yeah.
So we need to bury that old body.
Yeah.
And that is where baptism come in. And if they have never buried that old body, they will always walk around and think, oh, when is the old life coming and take over? It will always be a fight.
Yeah.
And I've seen many, many people come to faith, and because they put baptism ahead,
yeah,
again.
They fall back.
They fall back. They never break through. Why? Because we need to bury the old life.
Yeah.
We need to get baptized to Christ.
Yeah, and then they start believing that this is the life,
yeah,
which is not.
Yeah. But what is good, what I like, because you got a new heart, you got set free, and now you're on a road where you are free to decide.
Yeah.
What you want, because some people think, oh, now I'm baptized, everything is good, and I can lean back,
yeah,
and just put my leg on the table because I'm safe and everything is going to be good forever from now on,
yeah,
because I repent and believe and get baptized.
Yeah.
But this is not enough, because they rejoice there and suddenly they did not rejoice.
Yeah.
They got baptized, they rejoice there.
But suddenly they don't rejoice.
No, because the truth is that those people who rejoice after being baptized,
yeah,
I don't say it's wrong to rejoice, but you have to understand that even after you get baptized, you need to decide what road you want to walk.
Yeah.
The broad road that leads to destruction,
yeah,
or the narrow road led by the Holy Spirit. This is this walk of, yeah, spirit or flesh, the flesh or the spirit. Can you say something about that?
Yeah, because what's important to understand, as I started, that the Gentiles, they sin through living through the flesh.
Mm.
But the Jews, they sin by breaking the law. Now, why is this important? Romans 6 talks about that we die in baptism to the flesh, to the slavery of the flesh. Mm. And Romans 7, 1 to 13, I think, goes further that the Jews, they died to the law.
Mm.
So in baptism, we do not only die to the slavery of the flesh, but also to our own works of righteousness, through our own efforts to become righteous. You see, when somebody falls in sin, this is what I used to do. When I fell in sin, I tried to make a law to counter that sin.
Mm.
When people don't give money in churches, what they do? They're going to say, well, we have to give tithes.
Mm.
So we try to counter the law against lawlessness.
Mm.
But the Bible says that both of them, the law and lawlessness, are both of the flesh.
Mm.
Both of them. So all we have is flesh. We, of our own, the only thing we can serve is the flesh, either by putting the law on ourselves,
yeah,
or by just forgetting all about it and just living in the flesh.
When we can talk more about freedom later, but when we talk about freedom, and we have experienced freedom from sin, Jesus came to set us free from sin. Freedom from sin don't mean that we are never going to do something wrong. Because if I meet somebody who say, hey, I have never sinned, I've not sinned the last 15 years, I would look at him like,
he's a liar.
Yeah, he's a liar. Who do you think you are? Freedom from sin is really free to not go back to the old sin again. It is a freedom, but it's still a walk we need to learn. Before, when I was there, I did think that was wrong. But as I say, sometimes, oh, you did think that's wrong, then you had to do a lot of good things to just come back to this place you were before.
Yeah.
Now, if we do something that's wrong, oh, sorry, John 1:9, I'm sorry, God, I've not done it. And right away, you are free. You don't need to pump up
and make mistakes.
A lot of things.
Yeah, I make mistakes. I still do. But I do not continue in my mistakes.
And you don't feel, even when you do something that's wrong, you can stand up and walk from there
righteous,
forgiving right away and say, okay, it was wrong. I walk away from that.
Yeah.
Don't go back to it again. But there's a freedom. For me, I experienced a freedom that was like, I never came back to the same condemnation that I had before,
right,
where it was like taking over my life. Oh,
yeah. But now there is a freedom, we say. Okay, so we make mistakes, but we do not continue in sin. But how do we then live a righteous life? You see, the people of Israel were finally baptized and finally free of Egypt. But they continued to live, and they had a problem. Because what happened, just before they went through the baptism, 50 days after they were taken out of Egypt, God gave the law on Mount Sinai. You know, with a lot of smoke and fire, and they said, well, let's go up to the mountain. And the people were afraid, so no, Moses, you go, you go. So Moses went up to the mountain, and there he received the Ten Commandments, the law of God, written on stone. And then Moses came down the mountain, and what happened? He saw the calf made and all that stuff, and 3,000 were condemned right there.
I think it's Exodus 20, I think Moses get the Ten Commandments, as you say, come down. They didn't have patience to wait for Moses, so they said, where is that God who took us out? What is interesting, they make a golden calf. They did not call that golden calf from Baal or call them another god. He said, this is Yahweh, this is Jehovah, this is our God who took us out.
Yeah.
So they did not, they changed the image of God to something else to become a thing and start to worship that.
They tried to do it their own way.
They broke God's command. And then what happened then?
And then 3,000 people died. And then they continued to live in the desert, you know, to walk to the promised land. And actually all of them died. The whole generation except two, Joshua and Caleb. But what's interesting for us is that 50 days after Jesus died, which and Corinthians says that Jesus is our Passover, is our deliverance from Egypt. 50 days after Jesus died, something happened. It was Pentecost. When the law by fire, in tongues of fire, was written now on our heart. And not 3,000 were condemned, but 3,000 came to life. And that's why Paul can say the letter kills, the law kills.
But the spirit gives life.
True life.
And I would say, you cannot understand, you cannot understand salvation, Christ, without the Old Testament. You have to start there. That is why when I sit with the cops and cooks, I always start with Adam and sin, how sin came in.
Right.
We need to understand it, because otherwise many things will not make sense.
Yeah.
And there is only one true God. And I've heard people actually say that, oh, God in the Old Testament, he was a wrath, even God. And now we have, no. God is the same God. There is only one true God.
Yeah.
God is the God who took the people out of Israel. God is the God who did this. And you see so much Jesus in it. So saved by the blood, 50 days later, the law came, who should have brought life, brought condemnation, and 3,000 got killed.
Yeah, right there.
Jesus came with the blood, 50 days later, the Spirit came and gave life, 3,000 got baptized.
Got baptized.
And with the Holy Spirit.
Got saved, yeah.
Yeah.
So now the people of Israel had a choice after those 3,000 dies. Okay, we're going to go up to the promised land to live obedient or to live in disobedience, and which is called in Hebrews in unbelief. There we see the first sign that obedience or faith is not just an inner state of being. It has something to do, as James tells us, with obeying what you actually believe. But the problem is, our obedience cannot come from putting the law on ourselves, being self-righteous. Our obedience also cannot come from living through the flesh, to sin. We have no power to obedience. So there had to happen something, and that something is Pentecost, the Holy Spirit, the law given in our hearts, which is called the new nature, the power to do the will of God. Can I say Galatians 15? How does this work? Galatians 15 says... Galatians 5, verse 15 and 16 says, if you walk through the Spirit, you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Why? For the flesh lusts against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. There is a new desire entered in you right there when you were filled with the Holy Spirit. And this new desire inside of you is the power to kill the desires of the flesh. It is not through our own laws, trying and struggling and doing. No, it is through God.
And Romans 8 is also talking about if we by the Spirit kill the flesh. If we continue there, I'll just say if the New Testament offer, it's again talking about this in the Old Testament. We have Corinthians, Paul is there talking about Corinthians 10 especially, where he used that example. I can look at that maybe later. And then Hebrews. The whole book of Hebrews is an amazing book where he talks about Jesus' salvation. The whole chapter 2 is talking about Jesus' salvation. Chapter 3 is talking about Moses and Christ. Because they always put it together, Moses and Christ, Moses and Christ.
All the time.
And then they talk about the rest is upon the people of God and how we now continue and want to come into that rest. But then, as you said, they talk about that those people at that time, they did not enter into the rest because they sinned. But then he said, because they were did not believe, they did not enter. And then it was because of their unbelief they did not enter. Yep. And you say, you actually see that they did not come in because of their sin or disobedience. So the Hebrew, the author of Hebrew, is from end of chapter 3 and the whole chapter 4.
Yeah.
Try to read it. It's used as cinnamon, I think you said that, of faith is obedience, unbelief or is disobedience.
Yeah.
So, and it's so interesting because when you read that in the Hebrew way of thinking, if you believe, you obey. Yeah. If you do not obey, you don't believe.
Yeah.
But in our Western mindset, we think, oh, I can believe in Christ and be disobedience.
Right.
But this is not what the Bible says about
it. No, but it's not obedience through struggling.
No.
It's a new disobedience. Obedience
by the Spirit.
And that gives life instead of killing it.
So they were here.
Yeah.
They were celebrating. So even after, so you're actually saying, even after repentance, faith, and baptism, water,
there is a walk.
You can get lost.
Yeah.
There is a walk that needs to be walked before we enter into the rest God has for us.
Exactly. And that's exactly what Paul says. Were we not all baptized in the same in Moses and not all under the same cloud? He was saying, hey guys, these guys are condemned, but take care of yourself. Mm. And then he says a few chapters later, see, check if you are in the faith. Mm. Wow, that's a statement. Check, see if you are in the faith and how do you check it? Well, do you live in sin, yes or no?
If this is 1 Corinthians 10, where we see the whole chapter where Paul, he said that, they were baptized to Christ, they walked by the Spirit, and they walked by the cloud and the pillar of light, and they walked all of that. But still, even after all of that, the Bible said,
you still have a choice.
God did not find peace like in them, and they were killed.
Yeah.
And then we read that all of that that happened to them was written for us who live today. So we should not do the same as them.
Yeah.
Just before chapter 10, Paul say in chapter 9 that we are all in a run and we need to run for the prize.
Yeah.
We're not in a run where we run for a prize that's going to visit again, but we run for a prize that's never going to visit. What is that? That is the eternal life. And then Paul, he said, I am therefore not like a boxer who is fighting here and there.
Right.
I am hard to my body. I get my body to listen. So me, Paul says, so me who are preaching to others shall not be condemned. Or the Greek word, me who preach to others shall not be disqualified.
Disqualified, exactly.
Because what happens if you are in a race? You can get disqualified. What do that mean? You're out of the race. You're not coming back to the race. You're out of the race.
Yeah.
Paul, he knew that even he had a peace. We have a resting. We're not fighting for our salvation. I said,
no.
We don't believe in that.
It's all
not,
grace.
It's not by the law.
Even the obedience is through his grace.
Yeah.
It's not our own works. It's through his grace.
So Paul, he said that. He said, oh, me, I fight more than struggle more. Do more than most of my brothers. But then he continued, but not me, Christ who works in me.
Yeah.
So he was doing it, but he recognized at the same time, it was not because of his own effort, it was Christ in him.
Yes.
But the reason we want to get this picture is that there's so many people who first take salvation too easy.
Yeah.
They think, I believe and repented, I was told by the church that now I'm safe.
I'm safe.
Safe. Yeah, yeah. Safe and yeah. safe. And no matter what happened after this,
yes,
I can come in here and I can live like this and still go into the promised land, still go to heaven.
Yeah.
That is a lie.
No, and while all the yeah. almost all the parables of Jesus all warn us to take heed how we walk our life.
Yeah. It's amazing. Virgin, the five smart
virgins,
and, yeah.
the tree, you know, olive tree, well,
if you don't,
it doesn't bear fruit. And he says, well, let me dig around it once more, yeah, you know, yeah. and else just cut
the
it down.
The vine tree, if you don't obey me, if you don't stay in me, you also be cut off.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. yeah. yeah.
So how we say it, after repentance and faith, you are saved, but you're not safe. Yeah. Or how will you say you are safe, and but you need to continue and let God work in you?
Yes, exactly.
And then you need first to get saved from your old life in the baptism.
You cannot live obedience without the baptism.
No.
Why? Because you're still a slave to sin.
Mm.
How can you be obedient when you're still a slave?
So you can have a heart who wants to do what is right. You can have a faith in Christ, but you cannot walk the newness of life
right.
without getting rid of the old life.
Yes.
And then you come on the other side. But now you need the Spirit, the Pentecost,
yeah.
and you need to walk that road.
Yeah, because it's impossible in our own flesh to reap. The Galatians says, if you sow in the flesh, you reap corruption. Mm. But if you sow through the Spirit, you reap eternal life.
Mm.
And out of our own, we can only sow out of our flesh. It is through the Spirit that it brings life, because the letter will kill you, but the Spirit will give you life.
Yeah. So this is actually what, so try to put this together as a, can you take that very short
yeah.
and put together as a study in Romans? What do you read here?
All right,
in Romans?
So we start with being a slave in Egypt, Romans 1 and 2. That everybody has sinned, the Jew and the Gentile, everybody has sinned and everybody is condemned. But now, through faith and repentance, Abram believed and he was justified. Through faith and repentance, through the blood of Jesus, we are now justified, as the Bible calls it. Mm. If he would die right there, I think he would go to heaven.
Mm.
But the problem is, if he would stay right there, he would go back to sin. And then you come into trouble. As Peter says, 2 Peter 2 verse 20, if you are saved from the corruption of the world and you return to it and are overcome by it, you are worse off than you were before.
Yeah.
So we cannot stay in this place. We have to continue.
Mm.
As long as I'm alive, I have to continue. So we have to go to the baptism. So we are set free. And now we have a choice to choose righteousness or to choose the flesh. If I would die right there, just after my baptism, hallelujah, I am saved. I will go to heaven. Mm. But if I stay there, how can I live a fruitful, obedient life without the Spirit?
Mm.
Can my flesh bear fruit? No. Mm. If I stay in that place without the Spirit, I will not bear fruit. And Jesus says, if you don't bear fruit, bad news. So we need to bear fruit, and we can only do that through the Spirit. So we need the Spirit to fill us up. And now through the new desires born by the Spirit, obedience to that new nature given in us, we can live an obedient life. And then we can be as Caleb, who went to the promised land. You know, Caleb means to be unconditionally faithful.
Mm.
Wow. To be unconditionally faithful. We cannot be unconditionally faithful from ourselves. We need the Spirit to do that. And later the word dog was made from, as faithful as a dog. And only Caleb could go through the promised land through Joshua, Yeshua, which is Jesus again. So even the new generation, after the old generation had died, the new generation of Israel had to go through the Jordan, be baptized into Yeshua, in order to go to the promised land.
Mm.
It all continues again. We have to be faithful, not to our law and not to our this and that, no, to the Spirit, the new nature given in us that is giving life. And that is the walking out your salvation.
Mm.
And that is freedom.
Mm.
And that is joy and life. It doesn't kill.
Mm.
No, it brings life.
And I said, nothing from outside can take us away from the love of God. There's a whole list there, but there's one thing that is not on the list, and that is us.
Yeah.
Because we can walk away, we can walk astray, we can be deceived
yeah.
if we let somebody deceive us. If you look at this, there's people who have said, but is that not opposite what Torben is saying, that we said that baptism save, but baptism save us?
Yes.
Baptism, if you look at baptism, just do one study about baptism. Peter, Pentecost, Acts 2:38, get baptized for the forgiveness of your sins.
Yes.
Ananias said to Paul, wash away your sins.
There's literally a washing away from sin.
Romans talk about burying with Christ, rise up with Christ. Galatians talk about putting on Christ. Peter talk about the baptism that now save you. It's talking about a circumcision of the flesh, yeah. Not a removal of dirt, but a circumcision in your heart. The Bible used so many strong words of baptism.
So many, yeah.
If God have commanded us to say, go out and preach righteousness and forgiveness because I'm coming back in 5 minutes. I will preach, repent, turn to Christ, believe in Christ. If yeah. I have 2 minutes, yeah. I will do that.
Yeah.
But why don't we do that? Because we have more than 2 minutes. And Jesus did not say go out and do. He said go out and preach the full gospel, repentance, baptism, water, Holy Spirit, and continue in Christ.
Yeah.
What is problem is that what we try to preach like Peter on Pentecost, repent, get baptized, receive the Holy Spirit, and start to live in obedience.
Yes.
What evangelic meetings have done through the years, especially with the big crusades in the 60s and 50s, it came a little with Moody and Charles Finney and other people, mm-hmm. where we call the salvation prayer, because then they were preaching repent and believe. There's nothing wrong in repent and believe, but it's wrong if you say repent and believe and you are born again. Because yeah. there's no water and spirit there. It's the beginning, it's not the end.
Yes.
And you that was a part of salvation, but to say that somebody who have repented and believe, this is the full salvation, and right. now they can just relax. That is dangerous, because some of those people who don't get the baptism right away and the Holy Spirit right away, they start here, and then they walk around here for some time.
Yes.
And what is the result for many? If they don't get rid of the old body, they will end up in here. And if you preach, oh, now you believe and are baptized, so now that is enough. They will walk around here, oh, I'm safe, everything yes. is good, and I'm baptized, no matter what happened. They will walk around here yes. in disobedience, and like the Israelites, don't enter into the promised land.
Exactly.
So if we want to see this fruit, if we want to see more people enter into the promised land, it's so important how we introduce the gospel from the beginning.
Yes.
That we don't introduce it at one step now, and you can do the next if you want to, and then you can. No, we preach like peace on Pentecost.
Yes.
It's one package.
And this whole package is called faith.
It is.
It is the way. This is the way of life. You know, we say, well, when you repent, you come to faith, which is true,
yeah.
part of it. Mm. But there's more, there's baptism, and there is the Holy Spirit. And the interesting thing is, we need the whole Godhead. We need God the Father to repent to. Mm. We repent to God. We sinned against God. We repent to Him. We need to die in Jesus Christ, you know, and to rise up again in Him. And we need the Holy Spirit. We need all of God for our salvation. And we only take the cross, which is very necessary and true, because without the cross, there's no forgiveness. But we need the baptism to make a choice. To be able to make a choice, to be free from slavery, and the Holy Spirit for obedient life.
But the cross is Jesus died, He got buried, He rose up again. We die, we get buried, we rose up
exactly.
again.
Exactly. That's it.
And He walked here for those 40 days and went to heaven, and the Holy Spirit came down. Yeah. And if you look at salvation, I would say, I did a video a long time ago now on YouTube, where I talk about baptism, do that save? And I say yes and no. Baptism safe is important, it's part of salvation. But in that video, I also said, if somebody is in jail and he cannot come to water,
yes.
then I believe God can do like this and water on his head, and then, whoa, God, He can create everything out of nothing. I believe He can still be in jail, repent, come to Christ, and go to heaven.
Yes.
I believe that. I believe God, He is greater than that.
Yes.
But I will also, when he come out of jail, I will encourage him, of course, get baptized yeah. right away when yeah. you can. because it's not a good stage to be in if it is. But we cannot use that example now, because we are not preaching to somebody who's hanging on a cross or somebody who's who's in jail. We are preaching to people about following Christ.
Yes.
And we have often done the mistake that we have been preaching a salvation message more than a following message.
Yes.
Where if we only focus on the first step, then you can get many decisions, but you see as many people fall away and even more, and in some years there will not be many who follow and continue in Christ and end up here. If you want people to end up here, make sure that you preach the whole package right away.
Yeah, and that's why we need baptism to not happen after 5 years.
No.
We need it right away.
Yeah.
That's why we need the Holy Spirit, not after 5 years as a cherry on the cake. Mm. We need it right away.
Yeah.
It's the beginning.
Yeah.
It's not your whole Christian walk. Mm. It's the beginning of your Christian walk.
Yeah.
Wow, and that's amazing.
I love it. But again, as I say, if you are grown up in a church where you have not experienced the freedom in Christ and truly repented, or you have not experienced the freedom in baptism water, or you have not experienced the full filling of the Holy Spirit, everything we have been talking about, for you, it will sound like work and condemnation.
Yeah. Yeah.
But
that's true.
But for us who have the peace of God inside us by the Holy Spirit, who are testifying with our spirit that we are the children of God, we know, we can sit here and know that I'm there. I'm not there yet. I'm there. I am on the road. The early church did not belong to the Pentecostal movement or the TLR movement or the Baptist movement. They belong to the road.
Yes.
We are in Christ. He is the road that leads to eternal life. No one can come among him. It's only through him.
Yeah.
We can walk knowing that there is a walk that needs to be walked, but still have a peace and a rest.
Exactly.
That we are now in Christ and everything is good, and it's not a work-based faith.
No.
But if you don't have the Spirit, if you don't have that, everything you hear, everything will be work.
It will
work,
become law, because the only thing you have is lawlessness and law. So you will put the law on yourself, which brings death instead of the Spirit, which will bring life.
Yeah.
That's exactly it.
So, if you do, you have a last word for people out there you want to say?
Yeah, well, just what I wanted to add real quickly is, I'm not afraid that I won't make it to heaven.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not afraid that I will lose my salvation along the way. Why? Because it's the Holy Spirit that testifies with my spirit that I am a son of God.
Mm.
Wow, and nobody can take that away from me. But as soon as I move away from the path, consciously, you know, on purpose, that assurance goes away.
Mm.
And then when I come back again, I know, yes, I'm back on the right path. And that is our assurance, the Holy Spirit testifying in us, this is right, this is true.
I will end up saying that when I started with my repentance and faith, I got told as the first thing, now you are born again and that is all. I believe what I was told by the church, because as a new believer, you don't ask questions. You believe what you are told. And then I started to do what I was told, and I only saw this. I saw many decisions, but I saw few disciples. And I was also writing books about how to get saved without understanding what salvation was. Then God, the Holy Spirit, came and started to teach me by studying the scripture. And I started with the baptism thing, and it was not easy for me. It went against what the Bible says, baptism went against what I have learned. And suddenly I saw that baptism was a salvation thing. Because it was so clear, if you take the time to study, take Bible, study everything that's saying about washing away, baptism, and see what the Bible says. Suddenly you see that baptism is not just an outward sign. You see that baptism is not just a membership in a church. You see that baptism is part of salvation.
Yeah.
But then when I saw that, I was like, but then I don't get it, because I was told I was saved there. but I was saved, but now I'm saved again. But where do this come in? And suddenly the confusion started. And then I saw, like you saw in the Old Testament, And when I understood that salvation is a path, it's a road.
It's a road.
It's not, you get saved, you get saved, you get saved, but the one who keep on to the end shall be saved.
Yes.
When I understood that, first thing, it was first time ever, I don't need to have issue with baptism as part of salvation. I don't have issue with the Holy Spirit as part of testifying who we are in Christ and shalom God and the road we should walk. I didn't have problem with the righteousness that is in repentance and baptism. Everything came together. And it just changed everything. And I will say to you, many out there have got told, like I was told, like we were told, how many years did it take you to really get it?
19.
19 years. We have been grown up in church and been in church and was told something that was half truth, not full truth.
Yeah.
I would say you also don't need to just believe us for what we are saying. Study yourself.
Yeah.
What I encourage you to do, take Exodus. See some of the things with Moses and what happened. Take the book of Hebrew. And look at Hebrew, because Hebrew talk about that journey where it talk about that Christ is more than an angel. Christ is the Son of God, and the Israelite and their walk, and talk about that in chapter 10 it talk about sin and welfare, and talk about Moses on the mount. But now we honor Christ as even greater than that. And if we sin against the Son of God and all
even
of
worse.
That, even worse. So it we have that in Hebrew. Then take Corinthians 10. So there's different Arthur in the New Testament who are all using that example. So study baptism, take Hebrew, take Corinthians 9 and 10, and start to read it. Try to read it, try to check and examine if what we are saying is correct. And when you see that full picture, everything makes sense.
Everything makes sense. And the word actually now makes sense, you know.
You do.
You have the scripture, 1 John 1 verse 8, when you sin and you know, and you confess your sins, he is righteous and just to forgive you.
Yeah.
And then you go to 1 John 3 verse 8, where it says, well, if you continue sinning, how can you then be in Christ?
Yeah.
And this was so contradicting to me, but now I understand, I can make a mistake.
Yeah.
But I cannot continue sinning.
Yeah. And also in Hebrew, people talk about Jesus not as a sacrifice that had to be offered every year, but one good sacrifice that would take away our sin.
Right.
Sin conscience, sin guilt. That's that thing that we are under sin. His blood can save us from sin. And that is what salvation is.
Yeah, this is salvation. Yeah. You know, God saving us from doing sin, from living in sin. And that's wonderful. And that's such freedom. Yeah. And I'm happy and glad that I finally found it. And I found that when this came in order into my life, I started bearing fruit, not by hard work, but people just coming to me. Mm. And suddenly when I spoke and told them this gospel, it was bearing fruit to freedom and deliverance and all the stuff that I longed to see, but never saw. But when this came in line, yes, finally it works.
God bless you out there. I recommend still see the Pioneer School. I am also coming into that a little on the Pioneer School, not so deep at this, but see the Pioneer School, see our movies, connect with people near you and experience the freedom God has for you.
Amen.
God bless you. Bye-bye.